Season 3 of Notebook on Cities and Culture is brought to you by Carl Haley and Daniel Murphy. Maybe you have some experience that speaks to this, but I got here, I started wandering around this country, and I couldn't help but think to myself, this place looks exactly like Japan.
I think that's a register of how much better prepared you are than most of us. But I think I have the previous generation's equivalent, which is that all the time I was growing up, I had a great romantic fascination with Japan, based on the ancient poems I'd read and the 19th century woodcuts that I'd seen. And whenever I would look at one of those paintings, I felt this piercing sense of familiarity, as if I belonged more to that scene than to any of the countries around me or in which I was living. And the extraordinary thing for me was when I first alighted in Japan, really my first evening here, it looked exactly like the place I had dreamed of. And when you come to any place that you've been thinking about a lot, in my case, you're always braced for disenchantment and expecting to be proven wrong. So you're right that maybe Japan has a great gift for accommodating foreigners' notions of it and being the place that you're hoping to see. And it's certainly Japanese people have this rare, in my experience, unique gift for playing the part that they have been assigned or have assigned themselves to perfection, better than the Platonic model, better than the screen version, forever. So maybe Japan has that gift. So in 1984, it was the place of women in summer kimonos floating through a long white gravel pathway with lanterns bobbing on either side towards a huge graveyard filled with lanterns. And for you, coming exactly really a generation later, 28 years later, it's exactly the interesting, probably J-pop, clangorous, super contemporary thing that you've been absorbing.
Well, I am staying next to a pachinko parlor in Osaka, so I'm getting some noise. It is Notebook on Cities and Culture. I'm Colin Marshall, here in Nara, Japan, speaking for the third time with Pico Iyer, author of so many books on place. I rattled off all the titles on our first interview. We talked in our second interview about his newest book, The Man Within My Head, about Graham Greene and about his own father. And today, well, we're going to reference a few different books, I think, because I reread your book, one of your best-known books, The Lady and the Monk, before coming here, because thematically it's so suitable. It's about you going to Japan. It's about you meeting the woman who became your wife in Japan. And tell me how you look back on that book, your second book. What is that book to you now?
My favorite of my books, and the closest to my heart and the closest to my experience, because just as you said, it was about the discovery of the country and the woman who've become my life. And I came here 25 years ago, moving straight from my 25th floor office in the Time Life building in New York City to a temple on the back streets of Kyoto with all the fraught perils and false expectations that might suggest. And here I am 25 years later, never having left. So that book was really about my finding my home, finding myself, and finding the place that that had to be mine. And I think an important part of that book, really the core of it, which is still the theme of most of my writing, was the autumn. So it's so perfect that you and I are sitting here on this fairly blue day with the trees beginning to blaze all around us in the deer park of Nara, because I arrived here in this season. The first time I ever set eyes on Japan was on a layover at Narita Airport in late October, and that made me decide to come and live here. And then when I did come to live here 3.5 years later, or 4 years later, exactly 4 years later, it was in the autumn. And so I suppose what drew me to Japan was the beauty that's in everything melancholy and their keen sense of how to cherish the moment, because all moments are fleeting. And the mixture of buoyancy and poignancy that's at the core of Japanese aesthetic, that's also at the core of this season. So between Japan and the autumn, you couldn't be finding me more in my element than right here, right now.
That idea of the fleeting moment, it's so thoroughly in this book, The Lady and the Monk, because even, I mean, you get toward the end of this book, one of the major thread is about you meeting the woman you call Sachiko in the book, right? The woman who would become your wife after the end of the book. And, you know, reading the book, a reader, when that book was your newest book, would think, well, that probably didn't work out, because here Sachiko is, she's already talking so much to Pico about how, you know, she will cherish these memories when you've gone, when you're out of her life, and you write about how the Japanese do this. They're pre-nostalgic for things. They're savoring the sadness they will feel after it's over. And the book ends, if I recall correctly, on an ambiguous note. You might not be coming back. So tell me, how would you prefer that book be read? Because your fans know they don't know the story, but they know you're married to her. Whereas readers in the 80s, they don't know. Would you prefer people knew or didn't know how that story ended?
Beautiful. I love what you just said. And it's interesting because just earlier this week, one of my oldest friends in the world from the fourth grade was visiting with his wife on their first trip to Japan. And his wife was saying, I was just reading that all Japanese stories have sad endings. Is that true? And I don't know if it's absolutely true, but I think she was onto something there. So, as you remember, in that book, a large part of the tension is I meet Sachiko. I help to open the door to her, for her, to a whole new world of possibility and remaking her lives the way we do in America and claiming a destiny for herself that she hasn't even imagined before. So it's all about these fresh possibilities, playing against, just as you said, her Japanese kind of fatalism in the sense you can't change so much. And so to me, the theme of the book is about, will it have an American happy ending as per Hollywood? Or will it have that wistfulness of Japan where it's better to think of a thing than actually to hold it? And where, as you said, you savor memories, especially if they haven't brought you to where you expected. And so I deliberately, really almost the point of the book for me was to end it on a wistful note as a way of saying, well, I've become sufficiently Japanese that I'm choosing the Japanese ending. Though, as you say, in life I chose, and she very much chose, the American happy ending. But it was interesting because for years after that book came out, whenever I would travel with a new book, sometimes on Cuba or globalism or the Dalai Lama, subjects radically different. Every time when there was a Q&A session, the first question would be, what happened to the woman in the book? Now, thanks to the internet, as you say, people know that I'm with the woman from the book, but for many years they didn't. And it was always a source of concern, anxiety, sometimes anger on their part, because they felt, rightly, this guy has gone there, met what seems to be the perfect woman, had wonderful 5 seasons there, and then followed his agenda and left Japan because he'd only gone there for a year, abandoning this woman. And so I thought, well, I don't mind portraying myself as a foolish cad. If in a subtler way I can say, well, this book begins with me totally bewildered on a back street in Kyoto, not knowing right from left or night from day and jet lagged. And if it ends with me just having entered the culture sufficiently to feel that the ending should be all about autumn and about saying goodbye and about finally getting everything you want, but realizing that it too is transient. So thank you for asking that. I think about that a lot. And I've never wished that I wrote it differently. It was very conscious because when I wrote that sad ending, I was still in constant contact with my girlfriend, soon to be my wife. So I knew that in life it was going to go in a different direction. I think maybe the one thing, the deceiving or misleading thing that I did there was to present it as nonfiction while using, I suppose you could say, a fictional device there and creating an ending that I hoped would not actually be true, but to catch some deeper truth about my having entered that scene of Japanese parting and sadness that had always fascinated me when I just looked at it in a museum.
Now, this is something I was expressing my own anxieties about off mic before we started recording, but being interested in Asia myself and having recently acquired an Asian girlfriend, and we talked about Japan scholars with Japanese wives, how in your mind did that then or does it now when you're writing about these kind of subjects? I mean, the idea that somebody will romantically pursue what they also intellectually pursue, how do you conceive of the relationship between those two things?
Hmm.
Or aesthetically pursue as well. Let's not forget that element.
Yes, well, before we turn the mic on, you were saying that you see things all really as part of the same cluster or core, or heart. And that makes a lot of sense to me. I never thought of it before, but I think you're absolutely right. And so at some level, and I think this is very Japanese, mind, heart, and soul all dissolve. And each one is reaching to the same thing. And I think mind is the first to give way. I mean, I think that's the least important part of that conundrum. I mean, I think coming to Japan is a way of, in all senses, following your heart and going to a place where intuition is much more important than cerebration. And intuition, I think, is much less likely to mislead you. So when I probably was, I could call it an intellectual fascination, but I think what my fascination with Japan is, and was when I was growing up, was really probably an instinctive fascination, and to some extent a romantic and aesthetic one. And then maybe I tried to create the intellectual infrastructure around that by reading up on Japan, just as you have done so much. But really, I was following something much more mysterious, and I only trust, we talked about this, I think, the last time we were meeting, I only trust those things you can't explain, and I only trust those affinities that you can find reasons for, but you wouldn't necessarily believe the reasons. So same in this case. I could tell you all the things that why I would be intellectually drawn to Japan, but I wouldn't believe that. So my mother, for example, says, oh, you must have been Japanese in your past life. And that makes more sense to me than to say that it's the opposite of India, or it's similar to the England that I grew up in, or it's very different from California, and it was offering me a refuge from all those things. When I look back on that book now, so I wrote that book after my first year here, and now I've been here 25 years. Of course, I cringe at many, many things in it. But at the same time, I think there's a freshness in first discovery with all of us, with all the places and people that we meet, that can never be replicated. Mm-hmm. So at the same time, after 25 years here, now when I read that book, there are many passages where I think, how did I know that then? I knew more then than I knew now. And I suppose that's an ideal. And with Japan, it's particularly the case that I suppose Japan has taught me the deeper I am into any subject, the less I know about it. And that when I first came to Japan, I came for 2 weeks and I wrote a 40-page chapter in which I claimed to know everything. And then I stayed for a year and I managed 350 pages in which I knew maybe half of what was going on. And if I were to write about Japan now, it would really be about how I know nothing.
I want to clarify, is this a book you're now writing? We talked about this in the last interview, that you were contracted to do a book on living in Japan and knowing nothing about it, wrote about Graham Greene instead. Are you back on track with the Japan book?
Well, I'm wondering, because the fact of knowing nothing about it and the fact of having, more importantly, such a keen sense of what I don't know. You know, when I came here for a year, I didn't have a clue and I didn't care what I didn't know. I was in my 20s or just out of my 20s, and so I proceed full speed ahead. Whereas now, I don't know, actually. This is the first time in my writing life, which goes back 30 years now, that I haven't plunged into a project. And something in me is hesitant. I've been spending a lot of time reading John Cage, who I think is, to me, one of the wisest and most implacable explicators of the Japanese and especially the Zen tradition in America. And one of his great sentences was, I have nothing to say and I'm saying it. And of course, he, in the 1950s, listening to the lectures of D.T. Suzuki, instantly seemed to find in Zen some understanding that caused him to overturn all conventional notions of music and chants and much else. But as a result of all that, I think he had a keen sense of the virtues of not knowing. Not knowing is a kind of intimacy, I think a Japanese person would say. And also the virtues of not saying, of course. So maybe my fullest embrace of Japan will take the form of not saying a word about it or not even writing this book. I don't know. And maybe that's a useful humility I've learned from Japan and from the Japanese.
It's this writing aphorism that popped into my head recently. I don't know if it's true, but I thought to myself, when I was having trouble writing about a certain subject, I just wrote about it. I picked a different subject, wrote about that, and then I found I had written all about subject number one. I thought, well, if you really want to write about something else. It sounds a little too neat, but do you think it's maybe true?
Very true. In fact, I was just formulating quite a lot about that, along the lines of how if you want to write about yourself, write about a passion. Write about Graham Greene, as I did, or write about your favorite musician.
But don't say, I am X, Y, and Z. Because that's always just going to be an embarrassment, right?
Yes, exactly. And I think it's very hard to take, for any of us, to take an objective look at ourselves. Mm. But when we take an objective look at something we really care about, which probably is ourselves, we can describe it perfectly and catch something much deeper. And you know, I'm a very sworn enemy of memoir, because I think we're least to be trusted when we're writing or talking about ourselves. But I'm a great enthusiast about writing about one's passions, because I think that actually discloses more of us, and we're less guarded, and we have fewer agendas than when we're writing memoir. And yet all of us is right there when we're writing about a piece of work or a place or a person that inspires us. So absolutely right. They say every photograph is a self-portrait in some ways. Every painting is really about catching the painter as much as what he claims to be observing. And I think, yeah, with writing the same. So the other aphorism I would join to the one that you cited is, I've always thought, don't write about what you know, write about what you don't know. Mm. Which may be the things closest to you, actually.
And whether you're you or me or John Cage, what do you think is most to be avoided when we're writing about, say, Japan, an interest common to all three of us?
He would say, and therefore I now, as a student, might say analysis, knowingness, and taking surfaces too seriously. Because the surfaces, as you know, though you only just arrived here, are endlessly fascinating, zany, unique, unfathomable. But I think the longer I've been here, the more I feel any connection you try to draw between surface and depth is going to be very treacherous here. Mm. In fact, to this day, I probably couldn't say what their relation is. So the example I was using with my fourth grade friend this week was that when you're on a train here and you see a very demure matron in her early 40s dressed just like a woman in an English cottage in the Cotswolds, she is probably the wildest person in terms of her personal habits and private passions that you could imagine. And when you see, as you do everywhere here, a young woman in a microskirt with fishnet stockings dressed like she's just walking down the Las Vegas Strip,
Or indeed the Sunset Strip.
It's a safe bet that she may never have had a boyfriend and doesn't care about that and is in fact a very, very reserved person. Mm. And I don't think that's true in the same way any other country I know. That I think most of us feel that our clothes are an expression of ourselves, whether you're in England or California or most places, and they are. But here people adopt roles, and the roles bear no relation to who they are, and they're not just the opposition to who they are. They bear some very oblique and inscrutable relation. Yeah. So you can't infer anything from the surface here.
Mm. But then I do feel like, maybe this is just a hope that I have for Japan, that I'll find this out, but I do feel like here people wouldn't treat surfaces and depths in the same way, at least we do in the United States, in that there we're always saying, well, you know, that's their surface, but that's just a front. You got to look down deep inside where the real person is. We're obsessed with separating the surface from the real thing and finding what the real thing is, what people really are, what's really going on. And that always strikes me as a little bit pious. I mean, I don't know. I don't trust myself to find the real essence of anything. I don't know if I trust anybody else to. I feel like in Japan, surfaces may be deliberately constructed. They may bear little relation to what somebody is doing when they're not putting on that surface, but people don't treat surfaces as necessarily agents of confusion or evil, right?
Right. Brilliantly said, beautifully said. I mean, I can't think of a wiser way of describing Japan than you just did, and I've been thinking a lot about exactly the same things. And I often think that in California, say, where you and I have met before, the notion is it's really important to be yourself. And here, I've often thought, well, the notion is to be not yourself, but also not even to entertain that question. It doesn't matter if yourself or you're partially yourself or you're not yourself at all. Just as you said, I mean, your response is wiser than mine, that it's not a question to be entertained. And the Japanese are very good at not, as you say, not entertaining those questions, not getting all tangled up in needless or sometimes neurotic complexities. I think Oscar Wilde said something like, only the superficial don't judge on appearances. But Leonard Cohen, who together with John Cage, I think, is one of the really wise voices to explain Japan in the West, because he comes from a deep Zen tradition. I think he says something like, let's stay on the surface, that's plenty deep enough, or something. And yes, I think Japanese would feel that. So certainly you wouldn't have a Japanese, they wouldn't be caught up in so many of the issues that concern us. And of course, the classic sociological explanation is having a situational notion of self or of morality. And in Japan, it's the right and the honest, authentic thing to do to be one person with your mother and a different thing with your boss and another thing with your boyfriend and another thing with your daughter. And I think most of us are like that, but as you say, we piously assume we should be all of a piece. And the Japanese don't buy into that assumption, and so I think they're sort of liberated by that.
Puts a lot of us into therapy in the West, from what I can tell. Therapy's not huge here, right?
No, I did a piece about the absence of therapy many years ago, and at that point there were 4 psychotherapists in the whole of Tokyo, population probably 20 million. So, exactly. This is a wonderfully, I'd say, post-therapeutic culture, which has classic, deeply traditional ways of trying to work with the confusions that afflict all of us. And I think that's probably one of the main things I came here to learn, that kind of wisdom, because Freud and Jung have a lot to teach us. But these guys who've been around for 2,000 years and are still read, whether it's Marcus Aurelius or Lao Tzu or Confucius or whatever, probably are worth attending to, because the reason they're still read is that they've dealt with so many humans have found sense in them through so many different circumstances. So I think from a Japanese or Chinese point of view, psychotherapy is still a very young discipline. And these other guys have been, Buddhism itself is known as a training of the mind, and it's been around 2,500 years. So I'd probably, if facing an emotional problem, be more inclined to listen to a Buddhist or a Taoist or a Stoic or one of those ancient guys than a psychotherapist.
We talk here about our admiration for the Japanese people, but I also think, again, been in Japan one day, but having thought about Japan a long time, I've always thought to myself, A, wow, Japan is so interesting, and it's going to be such a fun place to go, and I'm going to go many more times, I'm sure. B, I'm very glad I'm not Japanese in Japan. Does that have any resonance with you as well?
Oh, Colin, again, you took the words out of my mouth. As you began that, I was going to say I would never want to be a Japanese. How interesting. And I think I would love to be an individual Japanese. And as I say, I've come here to learn about selflessness, attention, kindness, focus, so many of the qualities that I find to a huge degree and a humbling degree in Japanese people. But you're right, I would, and as you put it just perfect, I'd never want to be a Japanese in Japan because the social pressures are so intense. And that's why, the theme of my book, The Lady and the Monk, was really how not just the woman I married, but it seemed to me more and more Japanese women were realizing that they're full of energy and talent and direction and passion, and this society just didn't give them an outlet for it. So more and more of them were choosing to defect by marrying foreigners, joining foreign companies, or just migrating to another language and moving abroad. And I think when I wrote that book, the divorce rate here might have been 1 in 1,000, and now it's 1 in 4. So when I look at it, divorce is not by any means a good thing, especially when there are children involved. But I wrote about one person because I felt that this was the way Japan was quickly heading, and it's headed there even faster than I ever imagined, to the point where I think most Japanese women I know, if they have some spirit or enterprise or dream, are really leaving in droves. And the country is not going through a brain drain as such, so much as just a female drain and a female brain drain. They're losing these huge resources by not adapting to accommodate and to make the best use of the talents of half the population. So yes, especially I wouldn't want to be a Japanese woman, but
And I think on some of the friends I've made, the Japanese friends I've made elsewhere, and often, yes, they are Japanese women who had to get out of Japan for various reasons, and often, they'll have these abilities and this knowledge that will put me to shame, especially linguistically. They'll be on their fifth language that they can speak functionally. I'm struggling with the ones that I'm working on. We'll never get fluent in any of them, I'm sure, but they are so capable, and often they, even outside of Japan, are relegated to jobs I can't imagine they stand the tedium of. You know what I mean? It's still, their lot still isn't great outside of Japan, which only makes me think, they must really be escaping something from Japan. You know, that's if their place, what must their place in Japan be like, right?
So true. Absolutely. I was just in Darwin, Australia, a few weeks ago, and I met a wonderful Japanese woman who is now happily working to try to create links between Japan and Australia, so putting her expertise to good use. But she was saying that she had been working in Australia for 4 years in an office, and because she's so obliging and sweet and kind, everyone assumed she was unintelligent or a pushover, and people just said terrible, terrible things about her, even though she, I'm sure, was the most industrious and devoted person in that office. But, and again, people, you know, I think the Japanese, more than any peoples I know, are misread by the rest of the world because they perhaps have a different relation, different understanding of the relation of surface and depth. And one of the poignancies I often feel on behalf of my adopted country is that I think Japan has almost the worst PR of any country in the world. When I talk to my friends abroad, very few of them actually want to come to Japan. They assume that the country is forbidding and cold, and they have a very bad impression of Japan. And as soon as they come here, they start glowing and go back and home and say, people there are so kind and we never expected such humanity and to make such good connections with Japanese people. But until they make the effort to challenge that stereotype, they imagine Japan in a very unflattering light. And that's, I think, partly because the Japanese may be trained to be as invisible and neutral as possible. So we see their most impassive, the cliche used to be inscrutable face, and we see their most collective face, too. I mean, maybe not in your generation, but until a few years ago, the notion of Japanese abroad was traveling en masse in tour buses.
Snapping away every 1 second with the camera.
Yes. Which catches something very true, but of course that doesn't have anything to do with the Japanese individuals in that group, except the Japanese are trained to be, to think of the group and to accommodate to the needs of any group. And I think one thing that still strikes me and instructs me when I'm here is that, for example, my wife will have a boss for 4 years, and she may barely even know that person's family name. Because the boss is called department head. So she'll say, yes, department head. Or, yes, I play ping pong every day. And although I do know his name, there's one guy who's in charge of our group, and he's now known as the club boss. So we have to call him club boss. You know, I can't call him Mr. Fujita. But that is a way of disappearing literally into the role. So you cease to be an individual called Mr. Fujita and become this disembodied, generic, anonymous person who is the head of the ping pong group. And the Japanese are trained from a very early age to do that and to work with that. And in some ways, again, it clears a lot of the tension and neurosis out of things, because you're not thinking in terms of personalities, you're thinking in terms of roles. And the Japanese person has a very precise, perhaps inflexibly and imprisoningly precise sense of where he or she fits into the hierarchy in relation to every other role. So not something we would necessarily be comfortable with, but certainly something that makes things very clear-cut. He's the club boss. He does what he has to do. I defer to him because he's the club boss, and there's no argument.
I think about the Westerners who have had long-term presences in Japan that I know, and there's two paths, it seems like. Well, there's more than two, but two main paths, out of which many more paths fork outward. But some Westerners try to make themselves Japanese. They learn the language, they learn more kanji than a native speaker knows, and they Japanify themselves. You know, they marry a Japanese woman, they have a Japanese family, they stay here, they may never come back to their Western home country. They give themselves to Japan and try, always vainly, but, you know, asymptotically try to approach becoming Japanese, though they have to know they're never going to get there for a variety of reasons. But they do try, that is the goal. And then there are the Westerners who remain outsiders and in some sense take deliberate steps to stay outsiders in Japan. It seems like you've taken the latter course, and that former course doesn't seem appealing to me, the struggle to become Japanese, so I wouldn't be doing it. What have you found about what it takes to best stay an outsider in Japan?
Well, that's easy. And I think the key to, clearly, of that, I do hold to the latter course, and I think the only way to be happy in Japan is not just is to accept and embrace the position of being absolutely outside it, and to see all the possibilities that lie in that rather privileged position of diplomatic immunity, but not to push your way into a party where you're not wanted. And somebody said to me wonderfully, an English person who does speak very good Japanese recently, he only got complimented on his Japanese when he spoke two words. And the more fluent he was, the more unsettled Japanese became. And it's a famous trait that I think Japanese are startled, unsettled, and perhaps threatened by foreigners who speak very, very good Japanese, because it's as if we are stepping out of our role in the beautifully orchestrated play and pageant that is Japanese official life. And it's as if in the middle of a Shakespeare play, the guy who's playing the fool or the servant suddenly puts on the crown and pushes King Lear aside and sits in the throne, and nobody knows what to do because the whole play has already been written and King Lear has certain lines and the servant has others. And I think not to appreciate or enjoy role specificity and role consciousness if you're in Japan is suicide. And you're so right, because, well, I think a lot of people feel estranged. A lot of foreigners I know come to Japan and are deeply lonely and exasperated for year after year after year, partly because it's not more similar to, let's say, California. And it's true that if you come to Japan hoping to be let in, hoping that it will let down its guard after 30 years, hoping that it will suddenly reveal its Californian side because you speak more kanji than most Japanese do, you're writing a script for a life of disappointment. And you and I think, share a model in this regard in Donald Richie, who I still think is the wisest foreigner ever to have lived in Japan, or at least written about Japan. And he famously says, coming here, I exchanged belonging for freedom. In other words, the trade-off was, I will never be a part of the society, but in return, I can do anything I want. I can enjoy being a flaneur, observing this endlessly fascinating place. I can enjoy all the benefits of engaging with this gracious, rich, unexpected people. But the only price that I have to pay is never wanting to be one of them. And so he represents to me the wise way. But there are still so many who are constantly punching against the system for essentially blaming Japan for being Japanese.
That's what Donald Richie always wrote about, was his friends, his fellow Japan scholars, they would always get together in a circle and complain about the Japanese people. Oh, these people, oh, this country. And he was always the one, I mean, this was him writing about it, but he cast himself as the one who would never do that, right?
Yes, and who cherishes his place in the margins. And his beautiful book, The Inland Sea, I think it gains its beauty and its poignancy from the fact that he has one foot in the country but one foot out. And as he, and you bring it out of your bag as I cite it, as he strolls around the country, I think he understands it to a deep way. I think he's one of the foreigners who's entered the Japanese spirit profoundly and sympathetically, and understands Japan as well as many Japanese do, but he never presumes to know more than he does, and he doesn't claim to be more a member of the society than he is. And there's a real wisdom in that, and I think his great theme is about the confounding and ever-shifting relation of intimacy to distance in Japan. And Japanese people are so friendly and so emotionally open in many ways, but one's foolish if one translates that as something it isn't. And so, you know, I think, again, part of the beauty of The Inland Sea is when he'll be involved in a conversation with a Japanese person and get closer and closer and closer to them, and then he will extend a hand and touch the young woman's hair, and she will recoil. And he realizes he's actually read everything wrong. And it has been a wonderful conversation, but he was foolish and clumsy to read the intimacy of a friendship as an invitation to something more. And of course, that kind of thing can happen anywhere in the world, and does, but somehow Japan is much more much more ripe for those kind of mistakes. And so the lesson you have to learn from that is, don't presume you understand what's going on, and just have a keen sense that however much you're enjoying this encounter, it probably means something different to the other person than it does to you, and you won't know what that is. So err on the side of innocence and humility.
And what you've said resonates with the experience I had this morning anyway, walking across Osaka, where I'm staying, from Ikuno to Umeda, and walking down the street seeing not a Westerner in sight, thousands of people on the streets. There's just not a lot of Westerners in Osaka, and thinking, I can do whatever I want in some sense. Like, that's, I'm sort of floating above all this in a way. I mean, is that a feeling you still get if you're walking through the streets of Nara here?
Yeah, I'm much more uninhibited here than I ever would be in any other country of the world, especially those that I notionally belong to. And the more clumsy and buffoonish and loud and disruptive I am, the more I am playing the part that has been assigned to me of the clownish foreigner. You know, we have been cast as the equivalent to Bottom in Midsummer Night's Dream. We're the rude mechanicals, the token comedians who do everything wrong and put on the toilet slippers when we're walking into the living room and then walk into the women's room instead of the men's room. And fine to do all of that. There's nothing we can do. The problems come, as you rightly said before, if you do everything too perfectly. And then the Japanese don't know how to cast you within the play because you're not Japanese, but you're not playing the part of the foreigner. So who are you and what are you planning? And are you a Jesuit trying to convert them to a foreign religion by speaking perfect Japanese?
are you a Jesuit question? Korea is especially freaked out about, North Korea especially is freaked out about that. And Jesuits are, they have a... being scared of Jesuits is kind of a pastime in both the Koreas, I find. But that said, doing these walks, I find myself impressed by a couple things that I knew would impress me in Japan, though I didn't know quite why. Number one is the vending machines, all the drink vending machines on every single block. You know, you can buy a variety of coffees or teas, hot and cold. I was drinking corn soup out of a can this morning from one of those. And the fact that there are bathrooms in the train stations, these are simple pleasures. Very simple pleasures, but coming from the United States, they seem nearly unreal. And I assume anywhere else in the West, people coming from those countries, you know, Europe, England, wherever, are impressed by the same things. In fact, I've read them be impressed by that. What are we getting so impressed about with those two things? And the other, you know, foot bridges and whatnot, simple amenities just really floor us, don't they?
Yes, and I think most people would say ingenuity, but I would say thoughtfulness. Mm. In other words, you're right. I think people from anywhere in the world come here and say, why hadn't we thought of this? Why don't we have so easy, not expensive, and yet they make our lives so much better? And certain of the Kaniya countries, like China now, have co-opted, or Thailand or Singapore, co-opted many of these measures wonderfully and made their societies much more habitable as a result. But I think thoughtfulness is a better way of saying it, because I think what people are failing to register is that these little gizmos, which you see everywhere, tiny things but logical and made to make our lives more friction-free, speak to that same quality that we notice when you meet a Japanese woman in a coffee shop and you have a cup of tea with her and you order Darjeeling tea, and 11 years later when you go to her house, the Darjeeling tea is waiting for you. In other words, since... I think the main mandate for every Japanese person is to think about the other person, try to make him comfortable, and try to be responsive to his or her needs. They're doing it in a collective way in the vending machines. But I think what's subtler and less visible and more impressive is that they're doing it constantly when they're talking to you. And if my Japanese wife were with us as we speak here, she might have noticed if you were sweating, she'd suddenly bring out her handkerchief and present it to you. Or she might hear you cough and she'd race down to the nearest convenience store and come back with some cough drops. That's not her. That's some kind of training that is invisibly imparted at an early and formative age. That, again, is one of the things that I'm so keen to learn from Japanese. You know, I notice the longer I'm here, though it's not evident in this particular conversation, the less I talk, the more I listen. And I came here to learn listening, so I'm really grateful to the Japanese for that. And it's interesting, you know, one, books have curious lives, and you asked me about The Lady and the Monk. And one of its curious happenstances was it was mandatory reading for every cadet at West Point. And West Point, as I found when I visited as a result of this, has extraordinarily thoughtful, rigorous, and in fact, Japanese curriculum. Mm. And one of the things that they do now is every cadet has to learn everything about a certain culture every year. One year it's Cuba, next year it's Iran, next year it happened to be Japan. And they're probably the only other people in the United States who have read and thought as extensively about Japan as you have. And yet, the books that are given to them are not the geopolitical terms or the history of Japan or the kind of rather unimaginative books you would imagine. But in this case, they gave them Donald Richie's book, which seemed exactly the book I would suggest anybody read. And they gave this wacky book by me about falling in love with a Japanese woman, knowing, being wise enough to realize that it's not about that, but it's about engaging with ignorance in a foreign culture and otherness, which is something that every West Point cadet is going to be doing every working day of his life. And so I had the most unforgettable 3 days staying at West Point and talking to hundreds and hundreds, more than 1,000 of these cadets who'd had to read my book, and also getting their very uncensored responses to it, which I was really grateful for. In fact, as soon as I arrived, the colonel who was in the English department, who was in charge of me, maybe he's a lieutenant colonel, gave me 400 pieces of paper, and he said, well, before you start addressing them tomorrow, you may want to find out what they've thought about your book.
Oh, my God.
Yes, exactly.
And trembling, opening the manila folder. I don't know if I want to see in there, you know?
Exactly. In fact, I'm the kind of person who never reads a comment online in response to anything I've written, because you're right, I don't want to see. I know I don't want to see. But he'd given me this as a way of my preparing to know what to say to them, so I had to read them. And they were very candid, but also extremely intelligent and thoughtful. Mm-hmm. And many of them said what they didn't like about the book was that this wise guy seemed to think he knew it all. Hmm. And they're absolutely right.
Hmm. And having just reread the book myself, I'm trying to think, point out instances of where you did that. But it sounds like you've given the negatives of the book more thought than I have. Maybe you can elaborate on that.
Well, I'd say the whole book, because that's who I was aged. I was just 30 when I came here and 31 when I wrote it, so that's who I was at that point. So one thing that comes quickly to my mind is the treatment of many of the other foreigners, who are sort of blundering fools, who are meant to be a reflection of me. So by making wisecracks at their expense, I'm trying to show how I'm the most stupid of them all. But I do make lots of cursory judgments about them. I pronounce on Japanese society, even though I've barely arrived and don't speak the language. And as I said earlier in our conversation, if I wrote about it now, 25 years on, about Japan, it would be with much more in a spirit of saying how little I know, where there I was very keen to suggest how much I knew, and would be wrong with many. So I'd say half the book I can see now is wrong, or presumptuous in its assumptions, though the other half, as I said before, actually caught something that I wouldn't be able to see now. But in that larger sense of knowingness, which seems to be a theme I'm returning to in this conversation, I was glad when they pointed that out, because they were really saying it wasn't a very Japanese book. Mm. And if a Japanese were writing about something, ideally, he would have a keener sense. In practice, probably not. There's a terrific book called Strawberry Fields by a Japanese writing about California, and he was visiting it the same way that many of us visit Japan. Suddenly, without any preparation, speaking little of the language, and his judgments were sweeping about California as ours were about Japan. But at least when one's interacting with a Japanese person, they're very keen not to present their opinions, and very modest and very keen to efface themselves. And those are all, I think, really healthy qualities that not all of us have so much.
I'm thinking of another writer who recently in the last few years, wrote an essay about his time in Japan, and who aggressively makes his own ignorance and blunderings and failure his subject, David Sedaris. He went to Japan to quit smoking, and he got a good third of one of his recent books out of that. And he has a conversation in there that he transcribes actually about the vending machines on the street. And he's saying to someone, well, the vending machines are right out here, you know, and they're on the curb in Paris or New York or London. Those things would be trashed. And the person says, trashed? He's like, oh, you know, they'd beat the shit out of them. So why? It's something to do, I guess. But you can read a newspaper. Well, that wouldn't satisfy your basic urge to tear something apart. You know, that moment of just having to come up with a reason why vending machines in your country would be smashed up because they're outside. I feel like he's not necessarily wrong about the fact that amenities like they have in Japan wouldn't survive in Western countries. And I don't know why. I mean, you get led to a conclusion like, well, we're so full of impotent rage, we have to smash things. But I mean, what do you make of an assumption like that, that Japanese conveniences really can't be transplanted. It's too late for the West to have them.
Well, you could say it's an aspect of the same thing we were talking about that keeps foreigners on the outside, which is, I think to some degree, and Japan's not unique in this, many East Asian cultures may share it, or many traditional cultures may share it, the whole country is thought of as a family, a single community. And the reason the Japanese person wouldn't think of going and smashing a convenience store or going and destroying a vending machine and stealing from it is the same reason you probably wouldn't dream of going into your father or mother's room and destroying their stuff or, right. or stealing from them. You, why not ask for it? It's easier.
Right. They may give it to you anyway. Probably will.
Yes, exactly. And so if you extend that model to the entire society, which ideally they would do, certainly more than we do, then you feel a much enlarged sense of responsibility and harmony and community, and the crime rate is going to come way down. But the flip side of that is that a foreigner is the wild unknown, the wild card suddenly thrown into it, and is going to be very, very menacing because he's not part of the family and he doesn't subscribe to the same rules and he's liable to do anything, including wear his toilet slippers into the living room, as I was just describing. So in proportion to the sense of connectedness they feel outside their immediate household is a sense of excludingness and excludedness from the outside world, which is why Japan, conversely, has been so slow to be a part of the international order. I think the Japanese speak much less good English than most countries, even though those countries have less education and much more poverty, and somehow has remained in this somewhat self-created isolation for so long that as the world grows ever more interdependent, Japan is arguably being left behind and is having to realize that both with women and with people from other nationalities, either they learn how to make their peace with them and come to a more international way of dealing with them, or they'll be completely marginalized. So I suppose that's a poignancy there, that so many of the qualities that I admire and that have made Japan so brilliantly Japan have made it equally ill-equipped for the international order, and places like Korea and China, I think, have adapted to the outside world much better and more fluently than Japan.
What was the line you wrote? Maybe it was in Lady and the Monk, but Japan prepares its children only and ideally for Japan?
Well, that's actually quite a good line, I must say. I don't know when I wrote that. I don't remember if it was then in that book or not. But yes, I think that is true. In a way that, for example, my parents' country, India, is very much the opposite. And Indians, when they arrive in Manhattan, even if they've never been outside Bombay, hit the ground running and will be running the city 3 days after arrival. Japanese, 30 years after, will not. And I know, I was just saying to my wife recently, it's a source of much soul-searching at the moment that I don't actually remember the figures. But if you look at the Harvard class of 2015... there may be a few hundred people straight from China, People's Republic, a few hundred from Korea, surely a few hundred from India, and three from Japan. And it's just a statistical measure of how much the country is being left behind. Every year when the Dalai Lama comes to Japan, he comes every November and he travels around it for 10 days, and I always travel by his side, and we'll be embarking on that tomorrow. And whenever he gives a public talk, at the end of the talk, usually a woman will get up and say, "You know, can you give us a message for leading better lives?" Very good question, and cutting to the heart of things. And everybody leans forwards and waits to hear him talk about compassion and interdependence and responsibility and all the qualities that he embodies and speaks for so beautifully. And he says, "Yeah, one thing only, learn better English." And people are often taken aback, and they don't realize how practical he is. Right. But and then he says in a very sweet and soulful way, that here you are, Japan, you have such resources, such high technology, such great education. You're one of the strongest, wealthiest countries on earth. But you can't share your blessings and gifts and learning with the rest of the world just because of the language difference. And he always says that he himself, of course, has very broken English. But although it's broken, he has enough confidence at least to talk to people in English wherever he happens to go. I think he feels that there's a wasted opportunity that this country that has so much to teach us can't just by virtue of language.
I imagine just a clutch of Esperantists fuming in the corner. The English had taken the role they imagined for their constructed language, but, you know, we can't spend our time worrying about the Esperantists. It's a quality. I mean, when I got to Osaka, you know, the first thing I thought to myself when I was out in the streets was that I've got to find a way to spend more time here. You know, the experience, as you know, in Japan on the ground is very rich to an outsider, and it seems like everything is sort of all experiences are just provided right to you. You know, it seems like there's a lot to be experienced, and it's all quite accessible to you. But not to mention the vending machines with the coffee and such in them. That's going to be hard to give up when I have to leave Japan. But I also think of cities like New York or Los Angeles or Paris or London, cities where things get smashed up on the streets and where you can't trust people enough to give them bathrooms. There's a weird upside to that, and I don't know how to describe it, but it's something I wonder if I would find was strangely absent in Japan if I lived here a long time, and it's something that maybe it's hard to see for all of the filth and social problems of these Western cities, but they have a kind of, the best word I can use is vitality, that goes hand in hand seemingly with that danger and that lack of amenities and that sort of general mistrust. Do you know what I mean at all?
Oh, absolutely. You could call it energy, spontaneity, friction. I just by chance wrote an introduction to a classic Japanese novel by Natsume Soseki called The Gate. And the very first sentence of my introduction is, Japanese literature is often about nothing happening because Japanese life is too. And what I go on to say is Japanese people try to keep their voices as level as possible. The stronger the emotion, the more intense the situation, the more quiet they become. Everything here is about keeping drama to a minimum, and in fact, usually keeping drama to yourself, so that the surfaces of the public world are as manicured, silent, and you could say neutral, boring, as possible. And I know that many, many foreigners here hunger just to go to Korea, for example, not far away, because instantly they're in the middle of jostle and bustle and immediacy and people expressing themselves very loudly and vigorously and engaging in the kind of human discourse that the rest of the world observes. And you're absolutely right. If you come to Japan looking for that, you will be very, very frustrated and disappointed, because for 1500 years, it's been training itself in the opposite direction to be as even and quiet and essentially as invisible as possible, so that you come to read the silences and to cherish the nuances and everything between the lines and the explosions between the lines deeply, but you don't look for any drama on the surface. And it must be said, when we go back to vending machines, you haven't seen these necessarily so far in your one day here, but they also sell bottles of whiskey, pornographic magazines, used female underwear, and many, many other things that take many foreigner aback here. And people would say, well, there's a different kind of filth being seamlessly and spotlessly sold on the Japanese streets. So, you know, one man's dirt is another man's cleanliness. And I think in Japan, you run into that all the time. And since The Chrysanthemum, The Sword, and well before all the classic works of foreign writing on Japan, and every foreigner who comes to Japan tries to wrestle with these notions of how shame and guilt are so differently construed there, here, and that everybody is flawlessly polite but thinks nothing of vomiting in the street. Every Japanese man on the trains is impeccably dressed and ready to walk into a white shoe law firm on Wall Street while he's reading his horribly, violently pornographic comic book without a care in the world, and happy for all of us to see him doing so. Just that their notion of what constitutes, I won't say sin, but vice or embarrassment is so different from ours. What constitutes dirt, I suppose, is different.
And that said, how much of your strategy for successfully being an outsider in Japan long term, how much of that strategy has to do with, or how much does this, how much is the strategy undergirded by the fact that you only spend part of the year here?
Not so much by that, but I think mostly undergirded by the sense I'm still here on a tourist visa after 25 years. And most of all, I've never been a grown-up in Japan, and I've never played a part in Japanese society or even pretended or claimed to. So nearly all the foreigners who live here by working here. And most of them teach English, but in Tokyo, many of them will be involved in other kinds of businesses. And then practice poetry and pottery and drama and many other things on the side. So I'm probably the only foreigner I know who essentially, in my mind, lives here full-time while never doing a day's work in the society. And I think if I were engaged in Japan in a more real way, many of these exasperations would come home to me and I would be less indulgent of it and more frustrated by some of the things that are different and some of the barriers and invisible walls that remain. So I very early on made the choice that, as I saw it, to interact best and most happily with Japan, I would use it as a base, as a source of perpetual fascination, as a deeply foreign place that, just as you were saying, you in your first day here, probably wandering around in much the same spirit as I in my 26th year am, constantly confounded, surprised, and to some degree delighted by things that I can't hope to explain. But that goes back to what you were saying about not wanting to be a Japanese in Japanese society. I think there, if I participated more in the society, I would quickly be getting the worst of Japan. And I came to Japan to learn silence and attentiveness and these more private and interior qualities. And when I wrote my book, The Lady and the Monk, it was at a time when Japan was an object of huge fascination, the U.S. in particular, but almost entirely collective male and corporate Japan. Mm-hmm. Japan, the business behemoth that was buying up Rockefeller Center and Columbia Pictures. And to me, the graces of this country have always remained, you could say, in the female domain, but if not that, in the private, emotional, imaginative domain. That was what I was interested in, and still am now. So I don't feel the need. I feel that what I have to learn from Japan, I learn from the private world. And the public world has its own fascinations, but they aren't the reason that I came here. So it's a very curious way to be. And it's funny because, as you know, though many people wouldn't, I'm the most low technology creature ever, and I've to this day never used a cell phone and never seen Facebook or Twitter or any of the rest of it. But I've got to say, it's technology that allows me to live in Japan, even though all my bosses are in New York and London and Hong Kong and elsewhere. So I'm endlessly grateful, first to the fax machine and now to email, for me to allow myself to conduct my professional life entirely at a distance of many thousands of miles while living in the single most foreign and most fascinating country I know. And I often think that's one of the great beauties of this global moment that it's easy for us to forget, which is that in my parents' age, if I had felt, or certainly my grandparents' generation, if I'd felt the strong magnetic pull towards Japan, I would have sat in Bombay or California or England and read and read and read about Japan, probably never been able to dream of coming here, maybe not even likely ever to meet a Japanese person in my grandparents' generation. In my parents' generation, maybe I could dream of coming here once on a holiday that I would have to save up for a long time and spending my 2 weeks here and then going back to the world I knew. But I belong to the first generation that, thanks to technology, is allowed to live 1,000, 10,000 miles away from where one's work is. And so I suppose, almost inadvertently, I've turned that to advantage.
I've been speaking with Pico Iyer, author of many books, including the one we've referenced the most, of course, for obvious reasons, The Lady and the Monk, but all the way through up to the book we talked about last time, The Man Within My Head, about Graham Greene, his father, and more. And, you know, I'm thinking of a lot of your essays as well during this whole conversation, especially listeners, look up For Japan, See Oscar Wilde. A lot of talk about the parallels between England and Japan, which we've discussed before, but I've been thinking a lot about lately. In any case, Pico, thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Colin. Always a pleasure.
This has been Notebook on Cities and Culture. I've been Colin Marshall. You can keep up with the cultural creators, internationalists, and observers of the urban scene on the show at colinmarshall.org. Thanks. And special thanks to everybody who backed Season 3 on Kickstarter, including Paige Calvert, Jonathan Crow, Douglas Dollars, Paul Doyle, John French, Eric Graham, Will Graham, Umberto Grant, Kimberly Hahn, Carl Haley, Stefan Halperin, Matt Howie, Andrew Hovenick, Mark Hines, Andy Cooney, Mark Larson, Matthew Licky, Mr. Munvirzi, Rob Motz, Lindsay Muniak, Daniel Murphy, Aidan Nolman, Patrick O'Flaherty, Danny Olson, Michael O'Regan, Blake Riley, Rob Schultz, Cam Smith, Small Demons, Todd Shimoda, Kevin Smokler, Thomas Unterberger, Matt Warren, and Wayne Wright.